folks need to speak or call out or sing out or any of that, let me know, and so we can keep things moving. You were sent the questions by Joe, and they haven't changed, even though there's been a lot that's going on since I think we sent the questions out. You must feel like the roller coaster ride that many of us feel you've been on. That's great. Real quick, can you give just a bit of background about yourself, a brief introduction? Andrew Glass Hastings, tell us about yourself.
Sure. Thanks. Thanks for the opportunity to come and talk a little bit about what's going on in the mayor's office and the city of Seattle in terms of transportation. Deb hit it right on the head. There are kind of a lot going on right now, and so happy to be here and happy to engage in a dialogue. I'm Andrew Glass Hastings. I am Mayor Murray's transportation policy advisor. So I cover and touch almost every aspect of transportation in the city. Fortunately, I don't get to work directly on the viaduct-related work. So much to my chagrin, I'm so disappointed about that because that project's going so well right now. That said, so transportation is sort of a multifaceted topic, as you're aware, and we work on a lot of fun things. The mayor has a very aggressive agenda when it comes to transportation, and some of that you've seen already, and some of it is going to sort of roll out over the next little while here. We've engaged with the coalition in a couple of different ways already. Marissa was a part of the SDOT director sort of search process. Thank you for taking time and being a part of that process. It's we had a very broad sort of community stakeholder group that was involved in developing some really well thought out and really, I think, expansive selection criteria for the next director of the Seattle Department of Transportation. To a certain extent, I think many of the members of that group at the end sort of summarized, we're looking for a saint, we're a transportation saint in many ways. The expectations in this town around transportation are incredibly high, and trying to find someone who can come in to lead the department and help execute the mayor's vision, the community's vision for where we want to go with transportation in the next several years and in the longer term is going to be a big challenge. But I know there are people who are up to that challenge, and I'm confident we're going to have a good pool of applicants to choose from as we engage in sort of the selection process. By the middle of June, we should have a really good idea on who either the sort of mayor's choice for the position is, or at least the finalists for the position. The mayor is actively sort of recruiting around the country, around the world. He has very high expectations about the level of experience and skills, sort of breadth of just the creative thinking that the person will bring to this job. So we're really excited to have that marching forward. So I don't know if you want to jump into the.
Let me go to. We have the first question is one that is on all of the news headlines these days, and so I'm just going to set that aside and move the next question.
Great.
So I'm going to go ahead and read it out.
Let me say one thing first. So when I came to the panel conversation, a couple months ago, one of the things that I was excited about the opportunity to sort of follow up and engage in a little bit more of a dialogue, because it's always a really sort of unique and neat opportunity to be able to sit down with a group of people who have sort of the forefront of their minds how to make transportation better in the neighborhood, in the city, and that dialogue is important. And so I'm really hoping that that's part of what we can do today. I'm actually not prepared to answer all of those questions. I'm not an engineer, and don't pretend to be an engineer. Some of the questions that were sent were a little bit engineering for me and are a little more appropriate for SDOT to ask. So I'm more of a sort of a policy. My job is to help execute the mayor's vision for transportation, and I think each and every one of you can be a big help in us doing that. And so I'd really like to have the conversation focused sort of at that level a little bit more, and really talk about how and where the opportunities are to really work together and try to drive home and be successful in accomplishing some of the things that you're looking for in terms of West Seattle or transportation in general, very appropriate, you know, sort of topic step, you know, stepped in there in terms of sort of sound transit, where high capacity transit's going, and some of those sort of broader topics.
Right. We did have some SDOT folks here last month. Mm-hmm. Is that last month?
Yeah.
And time flies. And so many similar questions, or many obviously similar topics, and some of their answers are why the questions are phrased to where they are. So let's just dive into the questions. The first one I'm going to ask is, what will Mayor Murray do to guarantee that the viaduct mitigation money, state viaduct mitigation money for West Seattle, flows through to the end of that construction project?
So can we talk about the announcement that you made this morning?
If there's a feature of that in there, please do, because this
I'd really like to talk about sort of what I think is sort of the pressing issue right now, which is the what the mayor announced is a proposal to try to prevent the service cuts that are coming up, starting later this year and into next year.
Okay,
so
we do want to hear that.
We
definitely want to get to that. So if we could just touch upon these other questions and come up with that, because we know that you want to have time.
So the mayor's committed to ensuring that the viaduct mitigation is in place throughout the construction project.
The mayor's committed.
Yep.
Okay, great. Since the construction has a timeline that isn't as far out there as Sound Transit's, any particular timelines? He's committed to the full end, even if it's years and years and years and years and years.
Well, the construction of the tunnel, we don't anticipate will be years and years and years and years.
Good.
So,
okay.
So that's
okay.
There's certainly a timeline for that that should be moving forward.
I'm going to move on then. The next one is a question that a lot of people, it's a very long question, but it's very near and dear to a lot of people's hearts, some of them who couldn't be here tonight. In the case of a mass casualty event like an earthquake on the Seattle Fault, West Seattle could be cut off. The existing emergency hubs are not set up for critical medical emergencies, and our area with a higher isolated population than any other part of Seattle will be geographically cut off from our hospitals or from establishing a mass care site on location. When can we expect the city to have an emergency response plan that incorporates evacuation routes, defined contingency routes for inbound relief agencies for our area in place, and what part of the city budget will this plan fit into?
So what are some ideas that you guys have in terms of ways that the city should be responding to that type of emergency? And I think that's a key, in one way of looking at this, if there's actually an event that is so catastrophic that it, were to compromise the high level West Seattle Bridge, you're looking at a city that is in pieces in a number of ways. And so this question is appropriate not just in West Seattle, but all over the city that has, in many ways, that relies on, crossing water in a lot of areas, relies on a lot of different bridges. So this is a major concern that isn't just sort of, that's limited to West Seattle. But one of the things that I think, I'm not an emergency response expert. So this question isn't exactly transportation related. It's more sort of how does the city respond in the case of an emergency? So I would definitely want to make sure that the emergency responders and our emergency management team could actually answer that question a lot better than I can. But I'd like to
say, Andrew, it's not necessarily that high level. It's not that long ago that we simply had a very large winter storm, very extreme winter storm, which led to the high bridge being closed down repeatedly over and over because of ice and other conditions. Because the city failed to have a plan in place, the lower bridge kept getting getting shut down because they continued to let things like trucks run across it, that then jackknife going across the lower bridge. This resulted in not a small amount of West Seattle residents taking 3 hours, 5 hours, 7 hours to get home from work. People who had children who were left, let's be honest, stranded in daycare.
So what sorts of
employees who had to stay at the community centers to take care of people. So that's
totally, absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely. Big, you know,
well,
yeah.
Go ahead.
So Andrew, one of the my suggestion would be right now the Office of Emergency Management is rewriting its recovery plan for the city of Seattle in cooperation with its hazard mitigation plan.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that is absent from that plan on a citywide basis is a comprehensive transportation piece, evacuation route, a road management strategy, things like that. It would perhaps be as simple as the mayor having a brief conversation with the director of our graph and saying, you know what, I was on that plan, I will tell you. And then suggesting the transportation strategic plan.
And it even comes, we're used to other cities in the Midwest that have, this is a dedicated snow route,
mm-hmm.
and that's obviously transportation related,
yep.
even though it fits with snow, so if there are things that plan can say that the mayor can close certain areas to only emergency, anything but emergency.
Only emergency.
I know what I'm saying.
Yep.
But those are sorts of things that they are transportation related. Dealing with the emergency plan. That
and
right now is silent.
And the city does have designated snow routes. There are designated snow routes, and there are tiers that are set up to make sure that sort of the tier one routes are plowed and cleared first. And then as those are cleared, then
mm-hmm.
the city is able to deploy resources to clear, you know, additional tiers beyond that.
One,
and one of the great sort of, you know, I don't want to oversell it because it's something that the city should have been doing in cooperation with Metro probably a long time ago, was actually coordinating the snow routes with things like transit routes
mm-hmm.
to make sure that, and now you see every Metro route has a designated snow route that tries to, you know, avoid as much as possible the steep hills and other challenging terrain during those types of weather incidences, and they overlap, and so there's a much better cooperation between Metro and the city's resources to ensure the snow routes line up with designated
mm-hmm.
transit routes, which, you know, have since that 2008 storm have been able to keep the buses, you know, running more effectively during even minor storms.
We have a couple Marcy,
yeah,
and then Vicky, and then Joe.
One of the issues that is unique to this peninsula, that is not the case of your relative in the city, is that we have no hospital. And we have doctor's offices and an urgent care clinic and, you know, large practices. We have no hospital over here. So that's a major concern.
Good point. Vicki?
Well, and I'm wondering when this snowstorm, because I was in the Lower Queen Anne, it took 11 hours to get home because all three bridges were closed off in one. So in talking about suggestions, it seems to me that there's got to be dedicated roadways, not just for buses, but to get emergency transportation. People couldn't have gone to a hospital because the bridges were closed. So I'd like to see the mayor commit to making sure that fire, ambulance, even just urgent care people can get in and out and have a phone number to call and get through there. I was in the 65 quite, and they're going to close down these bridges just for safety's sake, even if they're not damaged.
Mm-hmm.
So in this plan that everyone
know that would be necessary. Have SPD go in the back of the swamp truck, bring it here, escort the doctors in, done. And, but, and so there's that. But the other one I wanted to say was we need long and short-term plans for evacuation routes and access routes. Because, I mean, what was it, 805 when the barge hit the bridge and all of the bridge shut down?
It was earlier than 85. It was 78.
Yeah. 78. I mean, how long was it before we had the bridge?
It opened in, they're doing the 30 years, so it's 84.
Yeah, so, I mean, there has to be executable plans that, you know, go on scale, you know, at least weeks.
Okay. Ray, you want to chime in?
Yes, following up on Marcy's comment, do you know if the city has a mutual aid agreement with the Highline Medical Center?
Well, the city has mutual aid agreements with other first responder organizations. And so, I'm not, is that a hospital?
Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, the city wouldn't necessarily have a mutual aid agreement with a hospital. We have mutual aid agreements with 911 responders, essentially, mm-hmm. with fire, police, and medical, you know, emergency personnel.
Right, but they have transports to that center rather than trying to go across hill.
Yeah. And so that's where, you know, depending on an emergency responder is going to take somebody to the closest facility that will meet the needs of whatever injury they're responding to, injury or illness they're responding to. So. If Highline, for example, is, again, not my specific area of expertise, but if that's closer and the situation is appropriate for the services that they can provide, they'll, you know, take them there first. Okay.
Good. I just want to put on the record for everybody who may not be aware that West Seattle is very lucky. You know, we're going to be cut off. We know we're going to be cut off. And we have folks like Cindy Barker, not related to me, who has worked really hard over the years to set up the emergency hubs with West Seattle and is moving into the rest of Seattle to set those, help those get set up. West Seattle right now has, I want to say, nine emergency hubs where when that disaster happens, those are the places that have radio ability to connect with the COC downtown. And that's a good place to know about it. If you don't know where this is, talk to us afterwards. So we'll move on.
One of the last things I'll say is that, you know, I'm sure you've all heard sort of the public service announcements in one form or another about sort of the 3 days, three ways.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 3 days is that's geared around, you know, having the ability and the resources to be able to sort of stay put and be self-contained, self-reliant to a certain extent, you know, for three days. In the event of, you know, major emergency, the city, all of the sort of collective government agencies don't have the resources to get to everybody immediately. And so, you know, that's one of the things that, you know, the city, the county, and others try to broadcast. You know, 3 days is really meant as sort of a minimum. You know, really,
total
people
minimum.
should be planning for more than
10 to 2 a month. Be realistic.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to move on to good questions, everybody, and good responses here. The next question I'm going to see many times, unfortunately, too many times, a single car accident has shut down access out of West Seattle. What will the city do to rapidly reconnect West Seattle's access?
So the city is, the mayor is, you know, committed to something he's calling Access Seattle. And really, you know, Seattle is behind the times on its, which is unfortunate given how sort of technologically advanced we are. But in our intelligent transportation systems, the ability to actually, you know, in real time change traffic signals from a central location, or have more sort of real time information for drivers trying to access different parts of the city. The city's a little bit behind on some of the sort of, if you will, modern advances in helping a dynamic transportation system respond to different, you know, changing situations. And so, given the concentration and the level of construction activity in particular in and around the center city, affecting routes sort of in and out of the center city, The mayor wants to prioritize what he's calling Access Seattle, something that SDOT is going to be sort of responsible for delivering over the next couple of years, is really improving the city's ability to respond in real time to situations like you mentioned on the West Seattle Bridge. So that will help the city be able to communicate more immediately and more clearly with emergency responders, particular SPD, to be able to get out in clear incidences much more quickly. So every minute of delay there makes sort of exponential impacts on traffic. Can have exponential impacts on traffic delays. So the ability to address those incidences quickly is really important. And one of the abilities of the city to actually do that quickly is to know what's going on at all times. And so Access Seattle is kind of a multi-pronged approach, and it's really geared towards keeping downtown and areas around and in and out of downtown open and accessible during this major period of construction over the next several 10 years. So that's going to be a major priority of the mayor going forward.
So I'm just going to throw in a few brief points on that. So this Access Seattle, it sounds as if it's really more of a what's in it for us, Andrew? What's the mayor going to do to make sure that West Seattle residents and businesses can get in and out when there's a car stuck at the bend of the bridge and Access Seattle is 3 years down the road?
Access Seattle isn't 3 years down the road. Access Seattle is a program that's a priority that's getting going right now. You already see it. I mean, it's already beginning. There are different components. There's a sort of technology component, but there's also just a staffing component, and frankly, there's also a sort of priority component. It's making this type of response a priority, so that incidences are cleared quickly, and different situations, like hotspots, is one way to sort of describe them. No matter if they're on the West Seattle Bridge, or in Lower Queen Anne, or in different parts of the city, can be responded to.
We have question and question and question. Amanda.
Hi, Andrew, how are you? So with that, SDOT. Can we talk a little bit about SDOT? In December, there was an intern manning the traffic control center. My question really is about SDOT. Has that been rectified? And as far as SDOT goes, how much can you tell us about who is running the Twitter and running the actual, I guess this is what the Access Seattle
is. Amanda, do we want to beat up on SDOT, or do we want to talk about ways to make this better? Because, SDOT's not a perfect organization. The city's definitely not a perfect organization. But one of the reasons why I'm here talking with you this evening is trying to figure out ways to sort of move forward and make sure those mistakes aren't repeated in the future.
Right.
And so that's one of the emphasis of the, and sort of priorities of, something like an Access Seattle program.
Great.
To make sure the resources are there, the technology's there, sort of the
it's already there. I guess we're kind of figuring it's already there. How is it being utilized right now? Because as far as I can tell, it's not being utilized very well. So what is the mayor's office doing within SDOT to rectify the situation of not having somebody running the traffic control center and not posting appropriate comments to inform people about traffic?
So the mayor's office is committed to making sure the traffic management system is appropriately staffed.
It has to. Is that right? Or?
It is committed to making sure that the traffic operations center is appropriately staffed.
Okay. We have over here. Marcy?
So my response to you is the West Seattle Bridge corridor needs to be a hotspot.
Absolutely.
Needs to be a major priority.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it number one?
I'm not in a position to say the number one. In terms of this group, absolutely, it's the number one. It's on my, it's on, it pops up on my phone on a every few minutes.
Okay.
Was
that your question?
Yeah.
Nikki.
So, to kind of build on what she was saying, we also have all the South
was either the end of Nichols or beginning of Nichols.
Yeah, and that was very helpful. But we also would like to have a phone number that we could call when we see it, a residence van, so we can support the city in getting that to that square.
Yep.
So
there's the number, 684 Road. It's manned 24 hours a day.
Could we get a sign put up on the
fridge? Yeah, that would be great.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, because I wouldn't have known to call that. But we could certainly support the city with that way.
Or it could be on the reader boards that have the top traffic times. Are there questions on this one as well? Yeah.
I would stick with the pin in that for your Andrew in terms of ideas. In terms of looking regionally, in terms of working with the state on issues, which is a big concern of this mayor, that working on ferries, that ferry, how ferries impact the city isn't just downtown and what happens with the new ferry terminal there, but as we pointed out, that currently the Southworth and Vashon traffic that comes through is a huge impact on the bridge when there's an accident. And so if there are ways to work on people have suggested moving ferries at peak times or more passenger ferries or whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yeah. I'm just saying that's a highlight, that's a ferry impact on city streets.
Yeah.
There is a suggestion that was made along those names that the mayor herself would probably be in a good position to execute, do some sort of study or survey for a week of everybody that's coming across us on there to determine where they're going. With your end destination. That's it. Nothing else. Are you going to QFC to shop here? Are you going to UW? Are you going to Bellevue? Are you going south to Renton? Where are you going? And that, if it turns out 95% of people are going to work downtown or beyond, why is the ferry not going to, Harbor Island or
you're suggesting to survey the ferry passengers.
It probably wouldn't cost that much money to put people with the boards. Mm-hmm. If they came out of the city's budget.
Yeah.
Just to figure out exactly that
problem. You have a captive audience for 30 minutes or so.
Yes.
That's very true.
A couple $1,000.
Washington State Ferries do sort of origin destination surveys already, so I'd be interested. The first thing I'd ask is when they did the last one on that line. Mm-hmm. This issue does come up, should those boats or some of those boats be going directly to downtown? Mm-hmm. And, I think you've probably heard before that the state response is, we don't have the capacity at Coleman Dock. We have a limited footprint at Coleman Dock. We have so many boats coming in and out there every day. We don't really have capacity to expand that to accommodate the additional boats. Also, I'm not in a position of trying to defend Washington State Ferries, but running those boats to downtown is a longer run and would cost them to operate. So that's also for an agency that has challenges covering their operating costs, that's something that I know is definitely
enough people to show up to boats. Joe.
Which is why Joe only. Just touching briefly back on the tow truck thing.
Yep.
I would really strongly encourage that being a reasonable possibility we could put into action fairly quickly. Sooner than later. And the reason that I say that is because there's going to be things that you learn after implementing that, how you can refine that process even better. When 99 does come down, having that service, everything around that service as well oiled as you can possibly make it is going to be critical for the people on this peninsula. If we lose any point in our transportation network, during that time frame, years of time frame, it's going to be really bad. So whatever you can do now, tow trucks, signs, anything that you can refine as a process in advance, this is a good thing.
Yep. Yeah. And we need to improve our collaboration with the state, the WSDOT's incident response, because they in the past have also staged tow trucks up and down sort of 99 corridor, and the ramps, that's part of actually the state's sort of responsibility. We need to make sure that we're not between the two agencies sort of dropping the ball on that area, because it's the critical nature of that infrastructure in particular sort of can't be overstated.
State, actually next month, our guest sitting in your chair will be the Washington State Secretary of Transportation, Peterson. So that's something that we will probably be checking in with her about as well, but we wanted to ask you. We have one more question from Ray, and we can keep moving on.
So, from SDOT traffic engineering standpoint, do they look at West Seattle as a bridge for the Pashon traffic coming off the ferry going over to downtown?
They look at it as a bridge for Pashon?
Just a bridge, because they're just passing through, just like going over the bridge.
As opposed to, I'm sorry, as opposed to what?
Looking at segments of, like, Fauntleroy, from Fauntleroy, Morgan Junction up to the junction.
Well, they're part of the capacity here.
Well, they are, but it's all through traffic.
It's through traffic versus...
It's different from downtown traffic.
So it has a different hierarchy versus traffic...
It might have
a... It starts in West Seattle versus traffic that passes through. That's a good question for the ESTA.
I mean, so no, they don't categorize that traffic differently, if that's what you're asking. I mean, it's traffic. They look at sort of the capacity and the number of vehicles that are traveling across the bridge as sort of point of reference. They're not, counting this one as a local one, and that's a sort of just a Vashon resident. You know, look at it that way.
Okay.
What are the current restrictions on opening the lower level Spokane Street Bridge and the First Avenue South Bridge for ship traffic during commuter hours? What are those hours now,
I don't know the hours off the top of my head at this point.
No. I question whether there are on the lower level bridge and the First Avenue.
There may be.
I have the answer to that. There's no restrictions on the ones that are that connect directly to Millie Bay and Puget Sound. Federal law goes right before that completely. There's some restrictions on anything that's in the ship canal up above the locks and relates to Twitter, because that's technically not the same categorization of maritime, which I can't remember what your structure is. Anything that's on the saltwater, basically.
All the ship canal bridges are closed to ship traffic. I mean, they won't let them open. Mm-hmm. Between, I think it's always used to be 4 to 6, mm-hmm. I assume it's the same, but it goes close to that. But I'm wondering if we can't lean on our friends in Washington, D.C. to change the rules on, because that's huge. I mean, one of those bridges opens, that locks it up.
Most we've been able to get out of them is sort of a soft, I wouldn't use the word commitment, sort of a nod to try to, sort of, as much as they can, avoid the openings during peak periods. But they won't actually, unlike the ship canal bridges, won't actually commit to keeping them down.
I want to keep moving. Mercy, you had a question?
Well, I just wanted to say it's my understanding that the lower bridge is under the auspices of the Coast Guard due to the shipping. Mm-hmm. And what they agreed to a few years ago was, when all this happened with the viaduct and everything, was that they wouldn't open the lower bridge in the morning commute, but they wouldn't commit to not doing it during the evening.
Okay.
That's
wonderful. And then we've been trying to get the Coast Guard.
If anybody knows any folks in Coast Guard that are way at the top, let us know. We're going to keep moving on here.
Maria Cantwell actually is the one to talk to about Coast Guard.
Good one. Okay, thank you. That's great news. I'm going to move on. This next question is probably more of that techie question, but we're all excited about it, so we're throwing it out. Why is the expansion of the West Seattle Bridge to State Route 99 North Loop, that's that big fun loop, not in any plans for bus access, meaning we believe that you could add a lane on that loop for a bus-only access, and we're wondering why that's not in any plans.
I was going to ask a little clarification of what the question was getting at. So it's sort of like talking about how buses would have sort of an exclusive lane on that loop to get up to the 99.
So it widens. They have their bus lane on the bridge, then they merge in traffic, and everyone does a little dance, and then the buses get off again. So it's widening that bend. Yeah.
So this bridge is a little tangential, but I think it hits on the sort of premise of the question that the you know, you heard the mayor this morning talk about the need to actually have what he called real bus rapid transit. And that, just to clarify, that wasn't meant to be a knock on Rapid Ride. Mm-hmm. Rapid Ride is what it is, and sort of the mayor acknowledges that Rapid Ride was a step in sort of a prioritization, an improvement in service in many ways, but was not bus rapid transit as it's considered sort of nationally or internationally. And so he also understands that, you know, the ability to deliver rail to a community like West Seattle or even Ballard is quite a ways in the future. So the mayor looks at as an interim solution, something that he hopes can be, you know, delivered, you know, in the relatively near term, more real bus rapid transit. And that's where you sort of get at what may be, I'm not sure if it would actually be another lane on that loop, or perhaps some other way of prioritizing buses through the corridor, but making sure buses aren't trying to compete with general purpose traffic as they're trying to get from, you know, in this case, West Seattle to downtown. Okay. So that would be, you know, something that we're gonna work really closely with Metro, not in, you know, not specifically in the package that the mayor announced this morning, but, you know, potentially as a part of the, you know, transportation levy renewal or other sort of transit funding conversations in the future.
If you could throw in your list when you're reporting back to the mayor, and the Transportation Coalition says it'd probably be pretty easy to widen or expand that loop to get a bus on the lane.
Yeah, that's done last month. The conclusion was that that's not making it money, but engineering-wise, they said this is not a non-trivial problem.
Right. And speaking of those SDOT engineers, last month, and moving on to the next question of when we spoke with them, there are solutions that can be implemented to give direct access from 4th Avenue South or 6th Avenue South to westbound Spokane Street Viaduct, involving ramps, flyovers, all kinds of great engineered solutions. When will the city commit to funding a study to decide which is the best solution?
So the city doesn't have intention of funding a study for that at this point. You know, one of the focuses is on the importance of a lander for crossing over railroad tracks. You know, that has been on the city's sort of laundry list of priorities for a while, and it remains there. In fact, the mayor and the county executive, you know, over recent conversations, sort of recognized the need to re-engage in that conversation and, you know, advance the effort to try to find the, you know, $180 to $200 million it would cost to do that. Primarily because that project in particular would address, you know, several needs. One of them being the long-standing need of the port and sort of the maritime and freight activities down in Soto to be able to get freight across the railroad tracks reliably. You know, the other is that becomes a reliability issue for buses. It's one of the primary reasons we're not looking at, you know, running, we and the county are not looking at running the sort of buses down 4th Avenue once the viaduct is removed, probably because of that unreliability that's presented by the railroad tracks. So create a solution to some of the reliability issues there. And, you know, then it would get you over to the recent investment that the city made made in the First Avenue groups.
Do you have a year for lander overpass being open?
No.
No?
There's no funding right now.
There's no funding.
No.
It was interesting listening to the gentleman from SDOT. One of them had been from SDOT 30-plus years.
Probably Paul James.
Yeah, he just knew everything. Anyway, what blew us away, or at least what blew me away, was him talking about, oh yeah, we studied that. No one, as we were doing something, we just kind of studied this as well, and actually that's how the 4th Avenue off-ramp got created, because someone had in their back pocket, oh yeah, we looked at that, we can do that as we move things around here. With that idea that SDOT is filled with innovative people who are thinking about these things, we think it would be good for them to continue thinking about using the 4th Avenue or the 6th Avenue for bus rapid transit, not for general purpose vehicles, but to have options. Yes, land is important, but other options for getting people out of downtown could be instances such as Estot coming up with a way to get the vehicles onto West Bethlehem Street via that. So, did anyone want to jump in since I just did? Should we keep going? Keeping going then. No year on Lander.
Got to find funding. How can you help us find some secure some funding for that?
Okay.
That's a big question.
Great camel.
Well, so this is where I'm serious and sort of engaging in a dialogue and sort of looking to you to try to help us because there are some real funding challenges in the realm of transportation and what limits our ability to do the exciting things that you've talked about tonight is primarily money. And we've just gone through a round of TIGER applications. Yep. So those applications are in. We hope there'll be another round of TIGER. That could be a great opportunity to really develop a very successful and broad coalition of this coalition, of a coalition beyond West Seattle, including the freight interests and others, around something like a TIGER request to the federal government to help us fund the Lander Street overcrossing. I mean, it's a high dollar figure, but it's not insurmountable. Go ahead.
You're really touching on our lab. One of the questions, are there opportunities to partner with the port to improve freight mobility and safe bicycle access? So you're talking about coming up with some of those opportunities to partner, and we are all over that. We're very, very in support of that, beyond just the commentary that we have here. Anyone else wanted to?
I would just add that, I think, and I don't doubt the commitment is there, but we're looking for a strong commitment from the current mayor. There's a very long history, unfortunately, with transportation projects that would benefit West Seattle being put onto a drawing board, possibly getting funding being discussed. In the case of the Lander overpass, a start of funding, and then it gets directed elsewhere by previous mayors and councils. So there's some sense that I'm not sure we would want to put forth lots of energy to try and get a lot of funding and then have it go to yet another project elsewhere in the city.
Would we be able to get a commitment that money would be locked away for these projects and not, say, pushed into another Mercer or Danny Nass or something else?
So, one of the ways that the region has been successful with TIGER applications in the past is that there's a firm commitment for a local component, sort of a local match of the grant. There's also sort of a broad coalition of stakeholders that are engaged and actively working with whether it's the city or Sound Transit or the state to try to deliver the federal piece. And of course, if the federal funding is delivered, such as the case for the South Park Bridge, none of that funding is that funding was locked into the South Park Bridge. There was the coalition there that was engaged in seeing that project funded was holding. City's feet to the fire, they're holding the county's feet to the fire, they're holding the state's feet to the fire, and then all that effort created the space, the political will, the opportunity to then partner with the feds and get a very large and very significant TIGER grant that helped actually deliver the full funding for that project and the South Park Bridge will open later this year. Mm-hmm. So it's that type of effort that is sort of what I'm speaking to. Of course, when you've got when you've got those pieces coming together, money's not gonna end up getting diverted to something else because you've got a lot of people who are sort of at the table sort of demanding the
yes and no. We have
a
man
with a
vision than that.
So when Bob was here, he said that there was $30 million set aside for the Lander Street project already. And I'm wondering if it's possible, maybe I'm opening a can of worms, to use that money to do a study for other options. So instead of like that going on Andrew Street right now, maybe that gets diverted to doing a busway study, whether it's from 6th on to the viaduct or 4th or whatever. Yeah. I mean, if there is money already there.
So I'm not quite sure what Bob was talking about. There is not currently $30 million in SDOT's piggy bank that's dedicated to the Andrew Street project. There has been money in the past.
Maybe for the design.
Well, maybe.
But there's,
you told us there was money in
the design.
Could have been some funding for design. But as far as I know, that project is not funded right now. So
the construction, because the design, I thought we led that it was designed, but there's no money for implementation.
Yeah, I mean, the project was mostly designed several years
yeah.
ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
My question is just go simple. I'm not familiar with this federal grant you're talking about.
So it stands for TIGER. It's, oh gosh, Transportation Investments Generating Economic Recovery. Yes. So it was actually the brainchild in the sweetest sense of the word, and of Senator Patty Murray, and as a way to look to local governments to come up with ideas on ways that could leverage federal investment to help. I mean, originally it was a response to the recession, to help projects that were shovel ready that could really kind of kickstart the economy. And so now it's become a very successful sort of federal grant program. And each year we're sort of warned that maybe the last year, and Congress keeps, partly thanks to Senator Murray, keeps bringing it back. So we have an opportunity, hopefully again next year. We'll see.
Yeah.
You mentioned before regarding the first time you saw Bridge, the kind of the story behind building up the political effort to get that done. Is that same engine currently running for West Seattle? I mean, do we have that level of emphasis and push to get some of these things done? Again, my concern is this: we're a year, maybe two, away from very, very significant traffic issues. It's not a mystery or a crystal ball. We know it's going to be very bad. And is there political willpower behind that statement to generate some of these things now? Are we currently applying for the grants? Are we looking at some of these things that have been brought up tonight as, okay, let's remedy everything we can before it gets really bad, because once it is, it's too late to start. Is that engine running? Is the political engine going?
I mean, in some sense, I'd say yes, but give me more specifics about what would we focus on? What's the there at this point?
Well,
in your mind,
man, not my sweet spot. But
all right, then I'm going to ask you to hold that thought, if you could, because I know that you have ideas there, and I also know that this is a good discussion to have. I also want to give you time to tell us about the mayor's plan.
Great.
Is that all right?
I accept.
Okay. Excellent. So Prop 1, several weeks ago, failed countywide. It failed by about 45% to 55% countywide. Seattle passed the measure by an overwhelming 66.5%. And that was in a special election when turnout in general, was quite low. Turned out by Seattle standards, was quite low. But Seattle voters responded overwhelmingly, saying that they wanted to prevent their bus service from being cut. So since the failure of Prop 1, the mayor told his staff to begin to dig through various options on ways that that he could propose to prevent those cuts from happening. And we didn't have to dig too far, because the options available to us to do anything very significant in terms of the cuts were fairly limited. And we looked at the results from Prop 1 back on April 22nd, and sort of the mayor came to the conclusion that we want to give Seattle voters the chance to say yes again to what they just said yes to. So what the mayor announced this morning was a $45 million a year proposal to prevent the vast majority of cuts that Metro currently has planned for the city of Seattle. About $40 million of that would be used to prevent the service reductions, changes to the current Metro service within the city of Seattle. And there's about $3 million that would be used for what the mayor called a regional partnership fund. He recognized that Seattle is a part of the county, is a part of the region, and that our residents rely on bus service outside of Seattle to get to jobs in different parts of the county. But also residents of different cities and different parts of the county rely on bus service to get to jobs in Seattle, which helps Seattle continue to be sort of the region's economic center. And there's also, talk about sort of impacts to the traffic today. He saw a situation in the not too distant future where the options for bus service would be extremely limited, and more and more people would choose to drive their cars, and that would further constrain already sort of bursting at the seams transportation system, and it wasn't a very pretty picture. So the mayor is proposing it's a $60 vehicle fee.
We've got a summary up here.
Great, there you go. 0.1% sales tax. So what was put on the ballot just a few short weeks ago. And together this would reduce the impacts to riders by about 90%. And then there's the regional partnership fund, and then there's the $2 million to round out the 45 is what the mayor thought was important to be true to what voters said yes to on April 22nd, which included a $20 low income vehicle fee rebate. So those who qualify are able to get a rebate of $20 back from the city via a city administered program. That in combination with the low-income bus fare that Metro is moving forward with, in addition to the mayor's commitment to preserve the night owl service, which the county is proposing to cut in the first round of cuts later this September, he wanted to make sure that the package was sensitive to the needs of not only Seattle, but the region, and also from a social justice and social equity perspective as well.
Do we have timing on the election?
So the plan is for this November, and the proposal will go to the city's Transportation Benefit District Board, which is essentially the council, sort of a different hat on, and they have until August 5th to put the measure on the November ballot.
We have some folks go this way since we've asked a lot of questions. Marcy, go.
Oh, I just kind of an obvious question. Do you have any concerns about the number of proposals that are going to be on the ballot in August or November in regards to things like preschool and parks and things like that? Has there been some discussion around that?
There's been a lot of discussion around that. And that was one of the primary reasons why the mayor didn't support a property tax as a way to prevent these transit service cuts from happening. Knowing that the Metropolitan Parks District will be on the ballot in August, the mayor hopes a universal preschool initiative measure will be on the ballot in November. Both of those would be property tax asks. And so knowing that there are existing transportation-oriented revenue sources, the mayor wanted to use those so that he considers it a sort of moral obligation that we move forward and pass the universal pre-K measure. He did not want to end up pitting sort of poor kids against transit.